Hello everyone and welcome to the session. Considering that we are in a chemical building, it's a pleasure to me to introduce the next speaker who also invented the chemical element osmium. And in the next 45 minutes, he'll give an introduction in Postgres and PostGIS and how to use that for OSM data processing. The stage is yours, Jochen.
Thank you. Right, so we are talking about Postgres on the one hand and OpenStreetMap on the other hand and mixing those things together. This comes from me. I've been using Postgres for like 20 years now and OSM for like 10 years now, more than that. And Postgres and PostGIS was always part of my toolbox when working with OpenStreetMap data. It's not perfect for everything. There's lots of things it doesn't do well and all of that, but there's lots of things where Postgres is part of a solution for, or can be part of the solution for some problem. And I wanted to give more people an idea of what it can do and where it fits in the OSM ecosystem and give you a chance to make it part of your toolbox too. And also this was prompted by, I'm seeing a lot of help. This is from help.openstreetmap.org, but it's also on the mailing list and so on. People ask questions around that has something to do with Postgres. They use this software to import something, and now it doesn't work in this other software, or all sorts of things like that. And there's, I can see there's lots of misconceptions what it can do in different cases, and I want to answer some of these. So this talk is basically about you have OpenStreetMap data on one side, you put it into Postgres, and then you do things with Postgres, and then you get the data out and do something with it. And all these bits we'll fill in and see what the different options there are. So we're first going to talk about a little bit of background. How does a relational database work? How does geodata comes into it? How do you convert the OSM data to bring it into the database, some use cases, some tools, and some odds and ends at the end if I have the time. This talk is not only made for you people sitting here at the moment, but it is made for people who can watch the video later and stop it and research some more. This is going to be a very, very quick overview of everything, and I don't expect any of you to remember anything after going this year and this quickly through it. You have to watch the video. So background, relational databases. There's many ways you can organize data that you have. You can store it in some a blob, you can have a tree, how you organize the data, or you can organize it in a table. And this is what a relational database does do. All the data is stored in a table or in many tables. And this is already something that's a little bit different from how OpenStreetMap data is thinking about its data model. So you have a table with here just, let's say, the members of some organization or something. You have a name for everybody. You have a place where they live. You have an age. Some data. We're not talking about geodata yet, but just about a way of organizing any type of data. You have columns that tell you what type of data there is. For instance, here, and then you have data sets. Here's the data set number 2, and there's the member called Jenny, and she lives in New York, and she has her age is 42. And you can look at the tab the other way. If you go through the columns, you have a column name, and there's all the names of all the people in this table in here. So that gives you the cross section of the column on the and the row gives you one piece of data, the smallest thing you can have in the database, an address in your database. In this case, this one name. The name is a text string. The age, in this case, is an integer. Relational databases have this thing called data types. Every field that you have has a specific data type, and you have to know what it is. And you have to have several different options depending on the type what you can do with this data. Sometimes you have an ID column that's sort of half special in relational data types. It doesn't have to be named ID or something. but it is very convenient to have one column where there's some kind of unique ID or a name or something that is unique for this data, for each data set is unique to get things again. And then you have something called the structured query languages, SQL. That's the main thing you interact with the database with through this language. So you say, for instance, select name from members. So it has, I'm looking at the members table, and I want to get all the names back. And what you get is a new table. I mean, you have the big table with the names and all the different columns. And when you say, I'm only interested in the name, you get back basically a new table which only has the name. And you can say, OK, but I'm interested in the name and the age. And that's the way you would write that. You can say, I want my data ordered in a specific way. Normally, the data in the database is not ordered. It usually comes back in the order you put it in, but it doesn't have to. And if you change things around, it can come back in any order. If you want a specific order, you say, okay, by age, and here, so Joe is the youngest one, comes first, and so on. And you can, in your query here, you can say, I'm not interested in all the data. I just want, in this case, everybody who's over 40. And so the new table that you get back has only those two people in it, and the youngest person is not in there anymore. This is just to get you sort of a rough idea how you would interact and how you'd think when you work with a database like this. There's not only select for getting data out, but there's commands for inserting data, there's commands for updating the data, and commands for deleting data. Insert, update, delete, pretty easy to understand. There's a few things I want to point out in this thing here. As I mentioned, Julia, the name here, that's a text string, and you have to write it in quotes. While 27, the age, is an integer, and you don't need the quote, or you don't use the quote for that because that's how Postgres was differentiate. And for those people who do programming, if you ask for something here for everybody who is a name Jeremy, it's not double equal, but a single equal in SQL. SQL can do a lot more, and I can't even touch what all the things that, are that you can do with relational databases. For instance, here you can say, I want the average age of all the members, and it will go through everything in the table. But you can combine this with average age of everybody who has this name or who lives in that city or whatever, these kind of things. And you can do even more advanced things if you are not looking at one table of data only, but looking at several tables. So if you have, like, let's say a customer database and you have one table that contains all the customers, then you have another table that contains all the orders that the customers have opened, then you can combine those two tables and do things with that, and we'll use that later on. So the magic of the relational database is you define a structure, you say, okay, there's going to be a table and it has this name and it has these columns and these types, then you store the data in this in those tables, and you can ask for the data back. And the database software does everything else behind the scenes. It figures out where to put the data and how to find it efficiently again and give it back to you. This is what the crux here, that's the important part, what the database offers to you. And this makes it interesting for all sorts of things. But the magic sometimes fails. I have to say this here. It's not perfect. You have to know a little bit how to structure your data and what happens behind the scenes. But when you start out, you just accept the magic as it is, and then when you get more and more into it, you learn more about what happens and how things work. So one thing which gives you a little bit of a glimpse into the underlying workings, and one thing you have to know pretty early on, is about indexes. An index is basically an extra table on the side where the database keeps the information that helps it find other information. So usually you might have an index, for instance, on a name. So if you're searching for a name in a table pretty often, you can say, tell the database to create an index, and that helps it find names. But it only helps it find the names. If you're searching for the address, it doesn't help at all, and it has to go through the whole table, each entry, and see is this the right, is this the same thing. So you create indexes for those things that you query often, and there's always a trade-off with indexes because the index needs space on your hard disk, the index needs time to be created, and it needs time when you update the data, then the database has to know, okay, this piece of data was changed, so it means I have to update the index and all that, and that needs time, but you get that back by having faster queries. There's lots of relational databases out there. 20 years ago, I could have said basically all the databases are relational. These days, that's not the case anymore. There's lots of other models. I'm only going to talk about Postgres. That's for our use case here is the most important part. Oh, PostgreSQL is an open source software, of course. Millions of features. It has pretty good documentation. There are books out there. There's lots of places where you can get information. Lots of people have given talks and about lots of different aspects of the PostgreSQL ecosystems. And there's also many companies who support PostgreSQL and who you can go to if you have the money for your company or something and you want professional support, you can also get it there. And it has a very powerful plugin system, which is going to be important for us in a minute. So, background. Database is now done. Background on geodata. There is something called the simple feature model, as some people came together and decided this is how we want to think about geodata. And this is a different model than what OSM is using. The simple feature model basically says, okay, there's three types of geometries. There's points, there's line strings, and there's polygons. And everything we do with geodata, we can do with these three types. Then there is this sort of special versions of those. There's the multipoint, the multi-line string, and the multi-polygon data type. So instead of just having one point, maybe you have in this case, three points, but you would want to see them not as three different points, but as one entity, you can see them as one multipoint thing. And the same with lines and polygons. And it's not hugely important at the moment, but there are some places where you might want to think of your data as one or the other. Okay, so we want to store this data in a database, and so the naive approach would be everything has to be in a table, we said. So we're going to make one column for the x axis and one column for the y axis, and that's why we can store a point where something is. That's the coordinates on the planet. But that only works for points. And it's also slightly cumbersome that we have two columns. The better approach that Postgres is taking, and there's a lot of other software that basically uses the same approach, it invents a new data type. So just like a name can be stored in a text column, and an age can be stored in an integer column, a geometry can be stored in a geometry column. And that looks something like this. So you have one column, and in the case of the point, both coordinates are in there, in the information that this is supposed to be a point. But this also can be extended to lines, line strings, or polygons. So you can have all the data that you need for a polygon, and that might be 50,000 points that you need to describe a complex polygon. They're all stored in this one attribute, in this one place in the table. You've seen the select command. You can get all of this back with one select command, with one thing, and you don't have to go through the list of lots of x, y coordinates or something like that. So to use that, you tell Postgres to use the PostGIS plugin. Create extension PostGIS, that's what you would type into the database, and mostly some setup script will do that for you. And that means Postgres loads in the PostGIS plugin. The PostGIS plugin gives you several things. It gives you these special new data types. It gives you the geometry data type. And in many cases, you know what type of geometry you have. You know that it's a point because you're storing in that specific table, you only want to store a point, or in that specific table, if you have a table with all the highways or something, you want always to store lines, then you can say, okay, I'm using a geometry, but not a generic one, but it always has to be a point or a line string or polygon. There's also geography data type, but that isn't that important in our context here. But that can sometimes be confusing. So we have the geometry data type supplied by this plugin. And now we have to talk about the way we find coordinates on the world. So as you know, probably most of you, the Earth is round. It's a sphere. It's not? We have to talk about that. And there are different ways of thinking about coordinates on this planet, and there's lots of different ways to put this on a flat map, and there's lots of different ways of getting pieces of if you only have a part of the world that you're interested in, and how do you store the coordinate, or how do you represent the coordinates there? And this is it. I could make 10 talks about just this thing, so I won't say any much more about that. This is called a coordinate reference system, or sometimes a spatial reference system. There's differences in what exactly this is, but PostGIS knows about over 5,000 of these different ways of basically saying where something on the planet is. And there's reasons why you sometimes need one or the other. But each coordinate systems has an ID, the SRID, spatial reference ID number, and each geometry that you put in a database is associated with that. So if you have two different sources of data and they use different coordinate systems, you can store them in the same database, and the database make sure that you can still track what is what, and you can transform things from one to the other. The most important coordinate references for our use case here is the WGS84. That's the coordinate system that comes out of your GPS, and that's what we all know and use with longitude and latitude. And then there's a web map creator. That's the coordinate system normally used when you create a web map that is the square-shaped web map. And the internal numbers used is 4326 and 3857 for those. So these things will turn up sooner or later, and that's why I wanted to mention them. And you can also say, okay, I want to have in my data type, I want to say that I'm only using a specific coordinate system here. But you can also leave that off and can have any coordinate system. Coordinate systems, by the way, in simple features and in all of these things are basically always written the x-axis first and then the y-axis, as in mathematics. So the longitude first and then the latitude, which is sometimes some people find confusing. There is this thing called well-known text, WKT, which is, you've seen a few cases already where I use this notation. It's just a notation how you can write a geometry down, and that's something Postgres can show you. It's not the internal format. Internally, it uses a very compact binary format, but that's the format that you often see and will use if you look at things. The Postgres database has indexes for normal one-dimensional data, like names or numbers or so, but geometric data is different. You need spatial indexes. And the PostGIS plugin also provides those. And there was a talk an hour ago or so in here also about lots of different ways of doing these indexes. So if you want to know more about this, watch that talk. And then So you have a data type, you have indexes, and then you have a lot of operations. Like the normal Postgres database gives you operations like adding two numbers, or we saw the average that it can calculate for you, or it can create, if you have a name and you can find the first three letters in the name or things like that. So that's built into Postgres. And the PostGIS plugin has a huge number of operations that work on spatial data. So they take geometries, the special geometry data type, and do some things with it. And this is where a lot of the stuff comes in that that makes PostGIS so interesting for OpenStreetMap or for any kind of geometric work. So one example, this is just an example of one command it contains. The command always starts with ST for some reason. ST contains. So in this case, you have two geometries. You have a geometry A, this polygon, and you have a geometry B, the point, and you're asking, is the point inside the polygon or is it outside? In Postgres, we'll say yes or no, and magically does that behind the scenes. And it will also use, in some cases, indexes to answer these questions quickly. Another operation is ST union. In this case, you have two polygons, and you say, I want all the area that both that at least one polygon is in, that the union of those two polygons. This is, in this example, it's a polygon, but it doesn't have to be. It can be a point and a line or many lines or whatever, and the union command will do that, will do the right thing, and it doesn't matter which types of geometries you have. Intersection, in this case, you say, what is the geometry that the two input geometries have in common? So you see the polygon A, and there's a line going through the polygon, and the part of the line that goes through the polygon is the result of the intersection command. Another one is buffer. Here you have the blue line, and you want to say, I need the area around the line. That's, for instance, interesting if you say, I want to figure out where's all the buildings that are near a road and so might be affected by roadworks or the noise or something like that. That's where you can use buffer for. Another example is shortest line. Here you find the shortest line that connects those two geometries, in this case, again, a polygon and a point. That we have this low-level things. Now we know about the database, we know about geometry stuff, and now how to get the OSM data into the database, because this is the OSM data model. You know, we have nodes, base, relation, we have tags and all that, and this doesn't always fit. There's a mismatch between the OSM data model and the relational data model that the database uses and the simple feature model that PostGIS uses, so we need some kind of conversion. So if you go again to this graphic that I showed you, we are talking about this part now, how to get the OSM data into the database. So first thing you have to think about is what data do we actually need in the database? In many cases, we don't need all the data. If you want to render a nice map, usually you don't care who was the person editing the data or when exactly was the last change done. So we can throw away this data. In some cases, we might want to have all the data from OSM with all the tags. But if you want to have a specialized map, it makes sense at that point to think about, okay, maybe you can throw away a lot of the data and not import it in the database. And all the work we don't need to do doesn't take time and doesn't take disk space and all that. And then we have to think about data types once we have decided what we need to import. And the big difference here is that OSM only knows about text strings. The tags have a key and a value, and both are text strings with a maximum of 250 odd characters. But the Postgres database deals in text, but not only in text, but also in integers and Booleans, and has different data types. So we have to think about it. If we want to work efficiently in Postgres, we might want to convert the data from the text format to a number format, for instance. So if you want to store the width of the of roads or of rivers or something, you might want to convert that the text format that has in the tag into a number, and that can be complicated if you have something like the width, which can be in centimeters or in meters or in inches or something. You have to think about what to do there. We talked about the way Postgres organizes its data with in tables with fixed columns. Tags, I can have zero tags or one tag or 100 tags on an OSM object, but the database has a fixed number of columns in its tables. So in this case, we said, okay, we're going to have one column highway, which has the highway tag, one column for the name, and one column that stores the information whether it's one way or not. And you have, for instance, here, this thing doesn't have a name. This one highway doesn't have a name. But we still have to store this empty space. And here, there's a special null value that you use for that. Because when we are in the tag world, we just don't use the name tag. But in the database, we have it. And in this case, again, one way, it's a Boolean value, really, that you might want that makes it easier to work with the data, so you have to convert it. There is a different way of storing the data. So this is sort of the classical model how relational databases work. But modern Postgres has extra possibilities here. It has an HStore data type, which is in an extension that you can load in. In the last years, it also got a JSON data type, which is built into Postgres these days, and which means you can store a complete JSON object, or in the case of HStore, basically a key value store very similar to our tags, in one column. So here we have a mixture. We have one column that says this is the place type, and this is just a string, a city or village or whatever it is that we got out of this out of the place tag. But for the names, we decided not because we don't have one name only, but we might have names for in different languages. We decided to have it in JSON or in HStore, and I wrote it in this format, which is not the format that is used with Postgres, just as a way of showing this, where we store again a key value kind of thing. And you could store if you want to, you can store all OpenStreetMap tags just in one column. It just gets a bit more difficult to use it than if you have it in separate column. And you just have to know that there's these different versions, different ways of doing things, and you have to figure out in your use case which one you want. Then you have to think about, as I said, all the data is stored in tables in Postgres, and from OSM you get lots of nodes, ways, and relations, and do you store them in just a few tables or in many tables? How do you organize the data there? And one sort of simple, obvious way would be maybe to have three tables: a nodes table, a ways table, and an area table. For instance, if you for the polygon stuff, that's one way of doing it. Another way of doing it is have a lot more tables and say, okay, I've got it: one table for restaurants, one table for bus stops, one table for rivers, and whatever, and I split it up. By not only by geometry, but also by feature types. And there's lots of different ways of doing this. And we're talking, later on we'll talk about use cases where one or the other might be more sensible. Handling, yeah, this is a bit a difficult subject and difficult to explain. So if you're looking at the OpenStreetMap data model, you have a way doesn't have all the information where the way actually is on the world, in the world, but it has a list of nodes that it uses. So if you want to store this list of nodes, how do you do that? And there's basically two ways. So the old way of doing it You need three tables. You need one table which has all the ways, one table which has all the nodes, and then you have a table in the middle which says, okay, the seventh node of the fifth way is that one, and you connect those two tables. And nobody understood this now, so watch the video and think about it again, and then maybe you can figure it out. But I don't have the time, so I have to quickly go over this. Or you can, nowadays with Postgres, again, you can store a whole array of IDs in one column in the ways. So again, different ways of doing it. Again, similar with relation members, how do you store the relation members in this tables, and how do you distribute that in tables? And there are different ways of doing it. Let's talk about geometry. So for nodes, it's pretty easy. Each node is a point. Each node has a latitude and longitude, so you can store it as a point. For ways, as we know, the way itself doesn't have a geometry. It has connections to the nodes. So you have to take the nodes. You have to find the nodes that make up a way and get the coordinates out of there, and then you can build a line string or a polygon if it's possibly a coseway, and then you can store that in the database in this geometry column that I mentioned. For multi-polygon relations, again, you want to create a polygon so that you can use it in this database with all these geometric spatial operations that I talked about. If you want to use those, you have to convert the data there. For root relation, you might create a multi-line string. And so depending on what data you have and what data you want to use in your database, you have to do those conversions. And depending on what you want to do with the data, something you often want to do is generalize the geometry. So if you have if you want to create a map, a typical map, then in the small zoom levels, you don't want to show every road, but maybe the major roads or the motorways or something. But it would take forever if you want to show on a Europe map. You want to draw the detailed motorway with thousands and thousands of points. So you simplify the geometry to something that looks similar enough on those small zoom levels. That's also an operation that Postgres can do for you. You can do it outside or you can do it inside Postgres. And you have to think about that, what data you might want to simplify. And that depends on the use case again. As I mentioned, you can do this conversion before importing the data in the database in some program. Or you can do it after importing the data. So you can import all the data in some kind of raw form and then convert the data in the database. Yeah? So import everything, convert everything while you're importing it, or importing it first in raw form and then working on that and creating derived tables with more specialized information for that. And most use cases, you do both, actually. You some of the data you convert while importing, and others you do later on. Because the database is very flexible, you can use all these magic operations in there and select your use and whatever. But if, for instance, every node you put in the node number 17 and then the node number 45 in the database and the node number whatever, and then later on there's a way that you want to import in the database, and now I need the information where those nodes are in the way, then you go to the database and say, give me node 17 back, and 34, and this one, and this one, and this one, and then you can build the geometry and import the way. This can take a long time, so if you do the conversion before that, that might be faster. So, as I mentioned, assembling the lines, that's one job that has to be done from the nodes and the ways you create line strings. And you can store either the nodes locations in the database itself, or you can store it outside. This is what you mostly do these days, in a special node location store that just is optimized for finding nodes again. You can get it back from the database, but because the database is a general tool, it optimizes, it's optimized in different ways and all that, then you're a specialized tool that can do this thing faster. You have to assemble the polygons. I mentioned that. And then one thing, very fundamental thing you have to think about is when you work with OSM data in Postgres. OSM data changes all the time, obviously. When you import it in the database, when something changes in OSM, what you want to do, you can either throw away your import and do a new import, or you can change the data that you imported and update it. It's basically two different ways of handling this. And it depends on your use case which one you want to use. Not all software, not all database schema support updates. And that's the reason why is this. So imagine you are only interested, you want to make a map of Heidelberg, and you're only interested in the data that's inside this white rectangle. And you have all imported all the data, and there's this yellow way is outside, so you didn't have, you haven't imported that one into the database because you're not interested. But now if somebody moves this node, so suddenly this one node is inside your area, and now you're interested. But you can't use that way because all the nodes outside, you haven't imported them, you don't have them, you threw them away when you imported. So you can't update the database with the data you have. If you want to have a database that's updatable, you have to store more data than you actually need at the moment so that later on you have everything to make your update. And this is only one case where this can happen. Also, if tags change, and it depends again on exactly what you're doing, but there is a lot of overhead involved if you want to have a database that can be updated. So in many cases, it might make more sense to only import the data that you need now, and then after a week, you throw everything away and do a re-import. I just said that. And again, the data needed for updating can store in a database or outside, and there's different options again. So one other thing we need to talk about. Normally, in most cases, you are only interested in the current OSM data that we have now, and that's what you want to store in the database. Sometimes you need all the historical data, also all the versions of all the nodes of all the ways or whatever, because you want to figure out what changed in the data or something like that. If you want to store that in the database, you need a different database schema, you need different ways and more complex ways often to access this data. So if you don't need that, that makes it easier. Use cases. So now we are at this, we see this graphic again, and now we're going to talk about the other side. What is it that we actually want to do with the data? And that will inform how the database should look like. I'm going to talk about these five use cases here. Of course, there are probably many more. First one is the API debug. That's the database, the main database that OSM runs is a Postgres database. So every time you access, you use your editor to change some data in OSM, this is where the data goes. You can install this on your own machine. All the software is open source. It's not easy to do, but you can do that. You can install it yourself, and some people have done that and have used it for other non-OSM data, for instance. But probably most of you will never need to do that. It is a Postgres database. Interesting enough, it doesn't use the PostGIS plugin. Because it came from a long time ago when we didn't have that, and today we might do it differently, but it doesn't use those things. So it needs all the data. It needs also historical data, and it's pretty complex because there's lots of people accessing the data at the same time. And changing things around, and has to keep track of this, and the data model has to be optimized to work with that kind of access. And basically, there's two things you want to do with a database. Sometimes you just say, OK, I want all the data that's in that bounding box. Or you say, OK, I want YID 17. Or I want to upload a new version of this way. These are the only things you can do. You can't even tell it to give you only data with a specific tag back or something. That's not what this database is for. And what it also does is create full dumps, the XML files, the PDF files, and all of this, and the replication diffs. So this is one specific use case for using Postgres and has a specific data model that it's used. And for all the things we talked about earlier, all the different ways of doing things, you decide based on the use case which one of the many options you use. The rendering is probably the most common use case for us here and for most of you. Many of you might have already tried setting up or succeeded maybe. Setting up a rendering toolchain. So rendering is turning the data from the database into maps, obviously. And it can be bitmaps, vector tiles, whatever it is. For rendering, the most important operation that you have is I need all the data in that area. It can be in the area of this tile, or if you want to do a printed map or something, maybe all the data that you need for the stuff that you're rendering. You probably have multiple layers for the different types of data that you want to render one on top of the other. And you want to say, OK, let's give me all the lakes first, and then you paint the lakes. And then you say, give me all the forests, and you paint the forests. And then you say, give me all the highways, and you paint the highways on top of that, and you build your map. And you need those generalized geometries that I mentioned earlier. And you have to think about putting them in to have fast enough rendering in the small zoom level. One thing is a lot easier. You usually have only one writer that occasionally updates the database, and lots of people reading from the database at the same time. And as I said, you might have regular updates, or maybe you don't have any updates at all and just throw everything away occasionally. Different use cases: geocoding. That's the search, basically, in the geo world. So geocoding is turning an address or a description of a place into a location, into a coordinates. And reverse coding is the other way around. I'm here at the moment. Where am I? In which country am I? In which road? On which road I am? For this, you need again a different data model. You have to build the address hierarchy. All the data from OSM, you have the address, but the address doesn't store the information, or partly stores only the information in which town or country it is. And you have all these different levels of countries, country and state and county and whatever. And you have to build this hierarchy. You have to figure out maybe in which postcode area something is. And once you build all this data, you need some way of having a reasonably fuzzy search where you can type in things and will magically find out everything that could match. Again, one writer, multiple reader, probably updates. A different use case is routing. Most of routing nowadays is not done in Postgres, but Postgres can be used for that. I wouldn't recommend it for most cases. There's a great routing, specialized routing software out there that is immensely faster with Postgres. But if you have a very special use case and want to play around, there's a PG routing plugin for Postgres. And if you want to do some routing that the routing engines don't support, software like OSM or Graphhopper, then that might be an option. And again, that data model is totally different. It needs to build a network of streets and calculate how expensive it is to go this way or that way, depending on or how much time it would take. And when you're using it, you need to find a route through this network. You need a totally different data model for that. And then there's analytics. This is a kind of grab bag thing where you do statistics or want to compare data, when you have different data sources, OSM data and other data, and you want to bring them together in some way. There's many, many diverse things which I've brought together here under this analytics umbrella. So one example might be you want to put one of those wind power stations somewhere. And so you need to find a place that has a lot of steady winds, and you might maybe you got a database that tells you for every place in the country how often you have winds in what direction and how strong it is, then you want to have it near high voltage lines so you can connect it to the power grid, because if the farther away you have to put your new line, the more expensive it becomes. And it has to be far away from residential areas, of course, because you don't want to disturb the people there. And this is something Postgres can do for you. You put in the data where the roads are, where the high voltage lines are. You put in the data where the buildings are, where people live. And you can get that from OpenStreetMap, and then you need another database that has maybe this wind database, and you put everything in Postgres and use these powerful spatial operations to find suitable places for a wind turbine, maybe. Other questions could be with public transport. How far is the nearest public transport stop from where I am here? So find all the public transport stops around me, figure out how far away they are. Or how many people live in a certain area. If you have a database of how many people live exactly where in which building or something, you could calculate these things. It doesn't have to be something outside. It can be about just OSM itself, and lots of people have done statistics like that. So who are the most active OSM contributors? And where are they? And where are they mapping? And these kind of things. So. That's something you could not answer from most OSM, normal OSM rendering database, because the information about the users is not in there. So this goes back to one of the first things I said. You have to find out what exactly the data is that you need in a database later on before you do the import. So for analytics, you need usually a flexible data import because you don't really know yet what exactly you want to do. You want to have lots of data in there, and then do your geometrics operation on that. Quickly about tools, one tool you will sooner or later use is just PSQL. It's a command line tool where you can type in the select statements and all of that, and sooner or later you have to learn SQL and all that, although there are graphic tools for that. What I always use, you have an editor by the side, a tip thing, the commands in a normal editor, and then cut and paste it over, and if I have to redo it again, I have a log of everything I did, and I can quickly change that. There's pgAdmin, an admin tool that you can use. QGIS, there we had talk about that already here, I think yesterday, which is a great tool to look into the data, and it connects as a graphical tool that connects to a Postgres database. And then, of course, there's all this specialized software, and that we have an OpenStreetMap. Osmosis, a very general tool, unfortunately, it's not maintained anymore. It can import the data in many different formats into the database, the API database, or so-called snapshot or simple schema. So for analytics, this is sometimes the right or would be an option to use that for importing data. OSM2PGSQL, you probably have all heard the name. That's the typical tool you use for rendering database and part of the rendering tool chain that OSM.org uses and many other people use. It, for instance, supports the HStore. I talked about that a bit earlier, but it can also put the data in many columns. There's an alternative rendering tool chain based on Imposm 3. It basically does the same kind of thing that OSM2PGSQL does, but has slightly different decisions on many of those questions we talked about. There's Nominatum, which is our search geocoding engine. It uses OSM2PGSQL to import its data, but a special plugin inside OSM2PGSQL to create this the data format that it needs. There's osmium, my tool, which is, it has a slight small component where it can create data for Postgres import, mostly for analytics probably. This is a pretty new thing that I've been working on a little bit, where I did some experiments, a flexible import tool that can create lots of different schemas and lots of different ways of importing the data. If you're adventurous, you can check it out. OSM2PG routing to import the special format that PG routing needs. Of course, that's the question that always comes: how much disk space do I need? A lot is my answer. For the whole plan, you need gigabytes. How much memory you need? Always more. So 64 gig probably. If you have less than that, don't try the planet. And the import takes days, hours, if not days, if you work on the whole planet. So the most important thing I can tell you, if you start out with this, start small. Take the data for a city only, and once this works, then you work your way up and take a small country or something till you figure out, because otherwise you're going to start something, it takes 10 days, and you still don't know, will it ever finish? So you need to get some experience to start small with small data and then work your way up and as you gain experience. Filter the data first before you import it if you can. That makes it, it just means less stress on the database. Load the data first, then create indexes and call analyze. That's also, we heard that in the index talk. You will need to do performance tuning if you work with planet-sized data or even other large data. You need to do performance tuning on the database, and that's a whole nother talk. I talked about indexes. Copy command isn't that important. There is a learning curve, try it out. It is an incredibly powerful tool. Right, there's other SQL databases, but they lack the geo support or they're proprietary, which we don't want to use. SQLite might be an option in some cases. Have a look at it. We are done.
Jochen, thank you so much for the journey, starting at the low-level database stuff and ending up in beautiful applications. I assume there are a lot of questions now.
You mentioned using a node location store that was separate from the database. Could you give some examples of that and why you might consider using that?
Yeah, so separate node location store. So OSM2PG SQL, for instance, uses that usually. They call it a flat node store. And it's a separate file on disk. And it stores nothing but the location of the nodes, nothing else, just the minimum data that you need to to assemble the line strings for the ways. And it's much faster to do one little lookup in one specific place in this file, then use your connection to the database and say SQL command, parse the SQL command, figure out everything, go through lots of tables and indices and give that back. So it's an optimization for this one specific use case.
That's for part of the import process.
Yes, that's for the import process, and once you have the data in the database, you don't use it in the database anymore. You will probably want to keep it for updates, if you do updates. But inside the database, then you don't use it.
Other questions?
I flashed everybody, and now all the brains are full. As I said, go to the video, and there's a question there. And watch it again, and use your pause button, and
Do you know if there's some kind of cookbook or place where, a good place to ask questions or?
There is no cookbook. There's like a million different things. And that's why I wanted to give this overview, that at least you have an idea where to look maybe for that specific case. You look in the documentation of that program or that program and all that. The place to ask for is probably the developers mailing list or the ISC dev channel. That would always be good. There's always people hanging out in those places who know about Postgres. Yeah, apart from that, or help would also work, yeah, usually. Yeah. Or come ask me later. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you again.